Welcome to part two of leading a children's worship service. Now, in part one, we talked about the importance of having consistency in your pattern, as well as having variety inside that pattern, so that kids, they're not doing the same thing every week. Now, it may be the same similar general pattern, but inside that pattern, there's a great amount of variety in the activities. You want your kids to be engaged. We talked about the importance of knowing what you're going to teach, as well as how you're going to teach that. The importance of walking away saying, what did my kids learn today, and did they enjoy learning that? Now, we went over a very simple general pattern, both for younger children's worship as well as older children's worship. We went through those patterns. Now, in brief, I'm going to walk you through those patterns again, and then we're going to break them down very, very specifically to talk about each individual pattern. Now, some of these will move more quickly than with others because we have entire sessions on them. So when we talk about control tools, we have an entire session on control tools, or telling a Bible story. Well, we have an entire session on making the Bible come alive. So we won't go as in-depth with those. We're just going to cover the surface. Now, a pattern for a younger children's church would be something like this: an entry activity as they enter the room. Then when you start, you'll welcome your kids and you'll introduce the day's theme, the control tool for the day, the key verse. Then you'll want to have songs, and many times those three elements, they're mixed in with your songs, your kids' church rules. I like doing the pledges, American flag, Christian flag, and Bible inside a younger children's worship service. An offering time, songs, a Bible story, then multiple games and illustrations and stories with life application that will reinforce your point for the day, review questions from previous week, competition songs, a prayer time, good listener awards, birthdays and announcements, as well as snacks. Those are all elements that you can find inside a children's worship service. Now, inside a preteen worship service, a little older, a lot of times we'll start out with high energy songs. We'll introduce the same basic things: the theme, the control tool, the key verse. Then we'll have a story or an illustration or a game that will lead into the dive time. In other words, this is our introduction. It's introducing basically where we're going to have our students read. The dive time is a short time where our older students take their Bibles, they read a chapter of the Bible, or as much as they can in the time that we give them. And we explained that actually a little bit more in depth in our last session, so we're not going to do that right now. And then from that, we springboard either into the Bible story or a review that will lead into the Bible story. And then, of course, it's supported with the same things we do in kids' church. There's a game, an illustration, an activity, a story, a testimony that reinforces our key point for the day, our Bible story, and our key verse for the day. And, of course, prayer time, announcements, you can recognize birthdays, those kind of general elements. Good listener awards. In our church, we do a good listener award only in our younger children's worship service. We don't do it in our older. There are some elements that are really good, but like our rules, we don't go over rules in our preteen worship. We figure at that age of their life, they really ought to know how to behave in a worship service. And so our rules for our kids, it's teaching them as much how to be in our own children's worship service as much as it is to be in an adult worship service as well. So now let's break these down and get a little bit more specific with each individual part. And so let's start. The entry activity, we actually talked about this in our last session, having something happening when the kids first walk in the room. Could be a video, something that's going to engage them from the moment they arrive. Something also, keep in mind, guests, something where a guest can walk in and they don't feel awkward or out of place or immediately, I'm going to use this term very gently, immediately threatened by relationship. You can overwhelm a guest by too many people coming up, wanting to talk to them, get to know them. Shy kids, they're going to move away from that. So using a video usually is really easy for a guest to come in, sit down, and kind of go, huh, because they're used to watching videos and they're drawn into videos. But it gives you a chance while it's playing to come up, have conversation with them without all these other eyes looking at you, ask 20 questions to the new kid. And so you want to introduce the theme. You want to do this in an interactive way. For example, if you're talking about joy, you could ask your kids to call out opposites. What's the opposite of up? Down. Your kids yell it down. Stand. Sit. What's the opposite of go? Stop. What's the opposite of short? Tall. What's the opposite of big? Little. What's the opposite of happy? Unhappy. What's the opposite of joy? And just watch. Some of your kids will probably go, unjoy. Well, there's no such thing as unjoy. And it gives you a chance to talk about the difference between happiness and happy and unhappy, and joy and Well, really, the closest opposite would be sadness. But you see, happiness depends on your happenings. It comes from the same old English word hap. You're happy because things happen, but joy doesn't depend on your happenings. You can have joy even in the middle of the worst circumstances. You can give thanks even in the middle of things that you don't like, situations that you don't like. You can give thanks in everything. Why? Not because you're happy with what happened, but because you know who's on the throne. Because you know God, you trust God, you know that God can turn anything that's bad to your good, to the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. So you see, you introduce it. Find a creative way to introduce your theme for the day. You know, or you might go, J, and your kids say J, and you say, give me an O, give me a Y. What does that spell? Joy. Joy comes from Jesus. And your kids say, joy comes from Jesus. J-O-Y. Joy comes from Jesus. And so a way to introduce your theme, typically when we introduce a theme, it's usually pretty quick. We show them something, kind of a show and tell. We illustrate, it's interactive, but we're introducing, this is where we're going for the day. Then introduce the control tool. Say that you just went J-O-Y, joy comes from Jesus. Hey, anytime I say joy and I point at you, I want you to say joy comes from Jesus. Now, there'll be many times in your lesson where you'll say joy, but the key is you point at them. I mean, stick out both arms real far. And so if you go, and joy, and you stick out your arms, your kids will go, joy comes from Jesus. And so introduce your control tool for the day. Like we explained in our session on control tools, a control tool is a way of kids remembering what you're talking about, as well as it's a refocusing tool. So instead of you saying, hush, listen, I was in a kids' church this last Sunday, and twice the leader, he said, listen up, listen up. Now, he only said it twice, which is pretty good during a children's worship, but there were so many, as he's doing it, I'm thinking there's so many control tools he could be using right now. And instead of going, listen up, all he had to do is pull that control tool out. You know, joy. Joy comes from Jesus, or J-O-Y, and then point to your kids. Joy comes from Jesus. So many things that you can do. So they're learning, but you're also refocusing them to, it basically says, listen up, eyes up here, without saying those things. And so that's a control tool. So introduce your control tool that's going to be used for that week. A lot of times we'll use a control tool for a month. There's some control tools we use throughout the whole year. You know, who should be number one in your life? Jesus. I mean, we can step in front of our kids any week of the year, say that, and our kids will give the answer. Now, if we step up in front of our kids and we say, what are you? Well, they may not know it unless we've been doing a month where the control tool has been, oh, I'm special. What are you? Oh, I'm special. Or who does Jesus love? Me. Ah. And they put a big smile on their face and go, ah, because they're happy that Jesus loves them. And so other real quick samples are God's got a gift. God's got a gift for me, and it's free. The truth is Jesus lives. God's got a call for us all. Maybe the leader says, big or small, and the students say, God cares about it all. They're learning about prayer. Or the leader says, keep your eyes, and your kids go, on Jesus. Or the leader says, listen, and the students say, and obey. Or maybe your control tool is you have two sides of the room. You point to one side, and you say, anytime I say, remember, and you point to this side, the kids will say, obey. You point to the other side, they say, every day. So you go, remember, obey every day. And so introduce your control tool. You can learn more about those in our session on control tools. But know this, almost any point can be made in control tool. Just have fun with it. You know, make them fast, make them slow, make them loud, make them quiet, give them an accent, have fun with it. But at the same time, introduce it to your kids at the beginning. Introduce the verse for the day. A lot of ways you can do this. Just be creative. Put it in a balloon, put it in a bowl of syrup, have your kids find it. You know, have it, you know, call up kids and the key word out of this verse, you've got the letters and it's all scrambled up and they look at it and maybe the word is salvation and you've got it L-A-V-O-N-I and so you're like Leviathans and you know, and the kids are laughing because you're trying to pronounce and then you tell your kids, okay, I'm going to give you 5 seconds, rearrange, and they rearrange, and now you're looking at it as O-N-I, you're like, Oni Love, you know, and so you're having fun, and then you put them in the right order, and you go, salvation, and then say, and here's our verse for the day, You know, and it's about salvation. Salvation means that God can save you. And so, you know, it's maybe it's Romans 10:13. So you point to one side and all the kids say, you know, whoever will call, and you say on the name of the Lord, and you point to the other side, will be saved. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And then you say Romans 10:13, and you have them do it two or three times, and do it loud, now do it quiet. And so they're learning the verse, you're introducing the verse, you're introducing the topic, you're kind of preparing your kids for where you're going to go. And a lot of times, like I said, we mix these in with songs. Now, the songs we do, some songs we do a cappella, and they're just fun songs. Actually, there's a lot from the 70s, 80s, and 90s that when you speed up the tempo, when you add your own personality, they can just be a whole lot of fun with your kids. And there's some old songs that you can do. And what's funny is when an old song is brand new to kids and they love it, and they have no idea that this song, it's a song you did when you were a kid. Use your songs also as teaching times. So if there's a song that fits the point, pull that out. Like if we're talking about choices, you know, we might do, whose side are you leaning on? And the way it goes, I'm leaning on the Lord's side. Whose side are you leaning on? And the kids say, I'm leaning on the Lord's side. I lean, I lean, I lean, I lean. I'm leaning on the Lord's side. And then it has other verses too. Whose side are you zodding on? And you do your arms like a big alligator mouth. You know, because when you say, I lean, you're leaning to one side than the other. Just make sure you don't clunk heads. And like alligator mouth, whose side are you zodding on? Kind of like the iZod shirts that have the alligator. So with your arms, you make an alligator mouth. It's iZod, 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 iZod. And then whose side are you sitting on? I sit, I stand, I stand, I sit, I stand, I stand, I sit. I'm sitting on the Lord's side. Whose side are you chewing on? Like you've got a big wad of gum in your mouth. So it would be like, whose side are you chewing on? I chew, like they're sneezing. And we always tell them, hey, if something comes out of your mouth or nose, just wipe it on your friend. And so you can do a cappella songs, songs that are from a long time ago, and you don't have to have background music or anything like that, not even a CD player. There are a lot of songs that we do use that have we play off of background audio, and songs with the words. We don't sing the words because, hey, these are professional singers that are already singing. And so we use Hillsong Kids a lot. We use some of Jana Alera, and you can look her up by her website. Hillsong Kids, the same. You can look them up by their website. We also use Seed Family Worship, and they're found at seedfamilyworship.net. Actually, Jana Alera, let me spell this. Jana, it's JanaAlayra.com, and then HillsongKids.com. Great songs to really get you started into children's worship. What I like about Seed Family Worship is they have songs that are scripture verse, Bible verse songs. And so there's a lot that you can bring in where your kids are singing scripture, which I love. And then, so we do songs, we mix that in with the control tools, with introducing the theme, with getting things going, getting things moving, introducing the topic for the day. Then we go over the rules for the day. And so kids' church rules, we mainly do this with younger children. The idea here is we want our kids to know what to expect. We want even a guest to come in to know, you know, if they need to use the bathroom, what do they need to do? So behind rules, there's a comfort for kids. Kids need rules. And it's important that you're upfront with your kids about what you expect and about how to do things. There's a security there. Because if you're not going to let somebody mistreat someone else, if you're not going to let them, you know, hit Johnny, you're not going to let Johnny hit them. So there's a safety, a security, and a comfort when kids know what to expect. So we go over the rules, and typically it's an acrostic. So we might go, everybody give us a G, and they say G. You know, G stands for give God your attention. Everybody say, oh, and everybody goes, oh, only get up if you have permission. So if you need something, raise your hand. One of our leaders will come to you. Everybody give me a D, and they go D, and say D stands for do not be a space invader. Now you say, space invader, what's that? Well, you have your space. The person next to you has their space. You want to keep your hands and your feet in your space at all times. And so you know, introduce just in a general way like that. These are our rules. These are our expectations. We always some of the ones we have are about giving your attention to God, about raise your hand if you need something, And then we usually have some that are about treating others right. In that case, that spelled God. And then we say, what does that spell? God. And today we want you to know that God has plans for your life. Or it might be good. And so they go, gee, give God your attention. Oh, only get up if you have permission. Everybody say, oh, only use good words. And that's not just a rule here for at church. That's a rule for anywhere you go. And so, you know, at church, you want to raise your hand. It's only get up if you have permission. Well, that's a rule for here at church. I mean, you're at home on your couch. Well, you don't need to raise your hand to have permission to go to the bathroom. But here, raise your hand. Only get up if you have permission. But only use good words. Well, that's for here at church. That's for at school. That's for when you're sitting on your couch watching your favorite TV show. Only use good words. So sometimes we explain to our kids, this is a rule for here, and this is a rule for life. And then D, do not be a space invader. And what does that spell? Good. And you know, we want you to know that God is good. And so, you know, there's all sorts of different ways you can use your rules as a teaching tool. So here's some other example of rules that you could use. You might spell cool, which would be care about others, treat them right. Only get up if you have permission. Only use good words. Listen to what God has to say to you today. You might do kids' church rules that are like R, kind of like R, but they're saying it kind of like a pirate. And the first R, respect God. And then they say R, respect each other. And then R, respect your leaders. And so your key word there is respect. And with each one you explain, you know, respect each other. Hey, you don't want to interrupt. So if you need something today, don't get up and walk around the room. You need to raise your hand. One of our leaders will come to you. Your rules might spell care, which would be C, care about others. A, always do what you know is right. And that's not just a rule for here at church. That's everywhere you go. That's the next time you're getting groceries, next time your sister picks on you. Always do what's right. Then R, respect your leaders and obey them. E, every day follow Jesus. And so you spell care, or maybe you spell love. L stands for listen. Listen to what God has to say to you today. God wants to talk to you every day. O, only get up if you have permission. V, victory is only found in Jesus. Hey, you want to win in life? Everybody wants to win. Well, the only way to have victory is to follow Jesus. And E, you have victory when E, every day, you live for God. Maybe your rules spell give, which G would be give God your attention. I, if you need something, raise your hand. V, value others. In other words, treat them right. Keep your hands and feet to yourself. Treat them the way you would want to be treated. And E, every day, live for Jesus. Maybe your rules spell life. L, listen for what God wants you to learn. I, if you need something, raise your hand. F, and all the kids say F, and you say follow Jesus every day. And maybe you have them repeat it. Say follow Jesus, every day, every day. E, everyone is special to God, so treat others the way you want them to treat you. You could spell gift, give God your attention. I, if you need something, raise your hand. F, follow Jesus every day. T, treat others the way you want them to treat you. Now, as I went through those rules, did you see the commonalities? Did you see how many different ways we had them say, listen to God? Maybe it was a G, give God your attention. L, listen to what God has to say. You know, or how many times we said, if you need something, raise your hand. Maybe we used an I, if you need something, raise your hand. Maybe we used an O, only get up if you have permission, or treating others right, or following Jesus. And so you can take a key word from what you're teaching that day, not only have it as a control tool, but also have it as part of your rules for that day or for that month as well. Now, a lot of times with rules, we will use them for more than 1 week. We will use them for a month or 6 weeks. And it's part of that consistency, so our kids get used to the rules and how we're explaining them for that season. And then we move on to new rules. And we'll tell our kids, hey, we're starting new rules today. Today, now the rules are love. You know, and a lot of times around February or Valentine's Day, we'll change them to love. Or maybe it's starting to get cool in the fall. You change them to cool. And hey, you're cool if you follow Jesus. Lots of different ways. Now, pledges and offering. And I mentioned this in the last one. I like doing the pledges with younger kids because I feel there's importance in them learning this. Younger kids, a lot of times, when I first went to the church where we're doing the children's worship service that we are now, and it's for kindergarten through second grade, very few of the kids could say any of the pledges. In fact, the only ones that really could were the kids we had that attended a Christian academy. Very few could even say the pledge to the American flag. Just simply, that's not something, they learn it in school, but it's not necessarily something that a lot of schools do a lot. And so is something that I just felt I wanted my kids to learn it. But I also realized at the same time that in the same way that a year later, they were really loud. In fact, I remember after doing it for a year, our first year of kids' church, you know, I would start the pledge and then I would stop saying it. And I told them I was going to do this and they would say it. And I told them, it is so great you've learned this simply by repeating it every week. And it occurred to me, in the same way, we can include other aspects. We can have our kids learn the Lord's Prayer by doing the same thing. The armor of God. There's passages of Scripture, not just individual verses, that our kids can learn if we build those into our kids' church on a weekly basis where they're repeating. Of course, with the Lord's Prayer, we actually encourage our parents to say that. Say that with your kids before they go to bed. I know every one of my sons, they were saying the whole Lord's Prayer really by about the age of two, because two, maybe between two and three, simply because we would say it with them every night before they went to bed. And so it was easy for them to repeat because they heard it so much. And so some other things that you can do there, as well as doing the pledges, or if you're going to repeat a lot, you might put it at a different point in the kids' church. We do the pledges. Usually I'll call up four volunteers, one to help me with the pledge to the American flag, one to the Christian flag. I'll say who brought their Bible. I'll choose a volunteer that brought their Bible. They'll help me with the pledge to the Bible. And the fourth volunteer will hold our offering bucket. And now the pledges to the flags, they really don't do anything except they stand there. And so I'll say, okay, Johnny, we're going to say our pledge to the American flag. Everybody stand up. That's how we show respect. Here we go, Johnny. And I do the old-fashioned attention salute pledge. And then I don't say it slow. And I actually say the pledges pretty fast. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. You know, because I've been in places where they said them really slow and you're ready just to move on. And I don't want this to eat a lot of time. I feel like it's an important segment for consistency and it allows you some variety for teaching points as well. And so, and then we turn to the Christian flag and, all right, Martha, we're going to say the pledge to the Christian flag. Okay, attention, salute, pledge. We plow through it. Okay, hold out your Bibles. We let our kids put their hand over their heart or hold out their Bibles if they brought it. They say the pledge to the Bible. Then I say, give our pledge volunteers a round of applause. And in kids' church, now we don't do this in preteen worship, but in kids' church, when we acknowledge people, we might clap for them. Okay, clap for them. Give them a hand. We might say, give them a round of applause, and the kids clap in a circle. We might say, that was great. Give them a standing O, and our kids will stand up and go, oh. Or we might say, give them the seal of approval, and they do their arms, like kind of reach across their arms, and kind of slap their hands against their shoulders and make a sound like a seal. So it's like flapping like a seal, and they go, arr, 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 arr. It's funny to hear how some kids make seal noises. And so give them the seal of approval. Good job. Have a seat. Now, if you brought an offering today while we sing this song, bring it up, put it in the offering, and sometimes we'll teach you just a mini short segment on this is why we give. Or we'll do our offering, and then afterwards we'll say, okay, now here's the reason we give an offering. And this is the difference between an offering and a tithe, and this is what your offering goes for. And so we use it as a teaching point, talk about the widow's mite and other stories with giving and so forth. Because it's an opportunity for us to teach our kids why you give. So they're in adult worship someday with their mom and dad. Now they're doing songs and we explain to them, this is why we worship. You know, this is why we study God's word. This is why we give. This is why. So any element in an adult worship service that they are learning why we do those things, they're learning about it in kids' church though. So when they go into worship service and they pass the offering plate, instead of going, whoa, why are people giving money? They know because they've learned in kids' church through our offering time as well. So the person holds the bucket. We sing a song. We sing the same song. This is just my pattern. I sing the same song every week for the whole year. And it's the old one. And it's one I grew up with. I've got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. Where? And the kids say, where? And we sing the song. And a lot of times on some Sundays, I'll say, I'm looking for some good singers. And I'll take the microphone and I'll go out. And I'm like, I've got the joy, joy. And I hold the microphone in front of them and they get to sing. Now, what I'm doing there is I'm adding variety, but I'm also helping our kids get used to talking into and singing into a microphone. Because I look at every one of my kids in children's worship, and I want every one of them, as they grow older and even at the age they're at, I want them to begin developing the skills they need to communicate the gospel in the same way that we are. Whether it's talking on a mic, singing on a mic, sharing their testimony, telling a story. If a kid comes up to me before children's worship and tells me a story about how they led a friend to the Lord, And I'll ask them, hey, can I share this story? You know, can we share this story? Can I call you up and you tell it? And if they say yes, I'll call them up, let them share the story. And if they say no, say, well, can I tell the story? And then I'll tell the story about them and won't embarrass them. I'll call them up. I will point out, can I tell them it's you? Well, yeah. And so I'll tell the story of how they led a friend to the Lord, or something's going on in their life, or they've got a funny story, but it ties with the point for the day. Use them. Give them an opportunity to minister to each other as well. I love calling up volunteers. I love hearing from them, letting them talk. You know, ask your kids. You're talking about fear. Go out with the microphone, and or if it's a small group, just ask them, hey, what are some things that you're scared of? Don't be afraid of interaction. When you lead a children's worship, even if it's in front of a large group, don't be afraid of interacting. Hey, don't let it be the stage is here and you sit there and there's this great gulf and big divide between you and me. No, be where the kids are. Let the kids be up where you're at. Let them come up. Let them help you lead songs. Let them help with the pledges. Use them as illustrations, volunteers, as to help teach the Bible story. Let it be very interactive. All right, let's move on to the next point, which is, you know, once we finish the offering, a lot of times we just jump right into the Bible story because we've done the introductory things. Nothing in our children's worship service is fluff. Fluff are those filler things. We don't fill things. If we put something in, we put it in for a purpose. But our Bible story is the main thing. That's what we want our kids to hear. We don't want them moving around. We don't want them going to the bathroom. We want them to get the Bible story. And we want to be creative in how they get it. We want them to walk out remembering that story and having loved how they learned it, having laughed with it, having been used as a volunteer, having been engaged. And so after the Bible story, we use games, illustrations, testimonies, stories, activities, whatever we can that's going to reinforce, giveaways, whatever we can do to reinforce that point, to encourage the kids, this is what we learned, this is the truth, and this is how this truth fits with your life. So it bridges that gap between I learned a Bible lesson and this is how I'm going to live that lesson in my life this week. And then we use review questions. In fact, this is our goal. We want kids to, in their teaching, we want them to find it, taste it, touch it, make it, know it, grow it, see it, show it, live it. And so run down that list and just ask yourself, as I'm teaching, is this what my kids are doing? Are they going to find it? Are they going to taste it? Ooh, what's a way they can taste this lesson? You know, can they touch it? Can they make it? Can they know it? How are they going to know it? How are they going to grow it, see it, show it, live it? We want them to be engaged. We don't want them just to hear. We don't want to talk and them listen. No, that's the least effective kids' church, where you have a speaker, you talk, they listen. No. In fact, I watched somebody, a guy that I'm training, he led a children's worship, and I watched him really kind of evaluating this last Sunday morning. And at the end, he texted me because he was going to lead our preaching worship, and he texted me because he was really down about how kids' church went. And honestly, I'll just say, you know, there were so many times I looked and I went, oh, you've got to use the tools that you have. You've got to, you know, he was doing more talking than he was engaging. And it was very obvious that he wasn't aware of where the kids were. Were they being connected with him? Was he reading his audience? He really wasn't. He was so focused on what am I going to do? And you could tell he was very nervous too. And he's learning. But here's the key point is, you know, he texted me and he said, I didn't feel like that went real well. And I texted him back and I said, remember, I said, you want to show it, not say it. Don't just say it, show it. Find a way to show it. And he came back in preteen worship and he had retooled what he was going to do. And it was so much more alive and it was so much more visual. And he was so much more comfortable because, you know, when you're up there and you're just preaching to kids, you ought to be nervous because the kids are not going to stay with you. And you ought to be nervous about that because they're not going to remember if you're up there and all you're going to do is read the story to them and talk to them about it and explain it. If you're going to preach to them, and believe me, I preach to my kids, but I preach to them in a creative way. I preach to my kids every week, but I use creative tools to convey that message. And so don't just talk is what I'm saying. Don't just say it. Find a way to show it. Engage your kids. Then use review questions. pull in things from last week, what you learned last week, review last week's topic. If it's a Bible story and you're going in chronological order, use that story to bridge into your story. A prayer time. Maybe you have them bow their heads, close their eyes. You give them 20 seconds just to talk to God. Then you pray for them. Or maybe you have them quietly tell God what they're thankful for. Or maybe you spin a globe and choose a place around the world to pray for. Or you share some prayer requests that you have. If it's a small group, you can take prayer requests from them. Many different ways. Have them repeat the Lord's Prayer. Each week, break down a different part of the Lord's Prayer. Teach it to them what it means, and then simply have them have a prayer time where you guide them through, you know, our Father. Well, today we're going to thank God that He sent Jesus to make a way so that we can be adopted into His family, so that we can be saved. And maybe you guide them in how to pray. You know, prayer time can be powerful, not just for the prayer, but for the learning that comes from kids learning how to pray. Maybe you teach them different segments that we'll talk about in the segment we have on teaching kids how to pray. You know, why do we bow our heads? Why do we close our eyes? Why do we say amen? You know, who am I praying to? Am I praying to God? Am I praying to Jesus? You know, what do I say? You know, what are certain things that I can pray for? So you can teach your kids how to pray through this prayer time. We do good listener awards. In our kids' church, younger kids, we choose one boy and one girl every week, and we give them a ribbon. Or sometimes it's a different prize or reward. But basically, the idea is we recognize one girl, one boy, and every week we tell them, hey, if you don't get it, it doesn't mean you weren't a good listener. It means we can only choose one. And it's one of our ways of introducing our kids, quite frankly, introducing our kids to disappointment. Actually, it's introducing our kids to real life. You don't always win in life. You're not always chosen. And you don't throw a fit about it. There are times we'll give things away, and not every child is going to get the same thing. So, for example, maybe we're giving out pencils, and we've got blue pencils, and red pencils, and green pencils, and yellow pencils. And so we tell our kids, you know, everybody's going to get a pencil, but whatever color you get, that's the color you get. So in other words, you're going to get what you get, and you don't, and our kids know this by now, they'll say, throw a fit. So you get what you get, and you don't throw a fit. And I'll say, that's right, or have a cow. You get what you get, and you don't throw a cow, and we joke around with it, you know? But the idea is you don't always get what you want in life. Now, in a situation like that, of course, we're going to make sure we don't give a pink pencil to a guy, but you do get what you get. We get rid of our leftover snacks. We have snack time, and after about 3 or 4 weeks, we need to use up our leftovers, so we'll have a snack time, and we'll have a variety of different snacks, and we'll tell our kids, hey, you might get this, you might get that, you might get that, but you get what you get, and you don't throw a fit. And it's a learning opportunity that in life, you don't always get what you want. And that's okay. And it's okay to be sad about it, but it's not okay to pout. It's not okay to complain. The Bible says do all things without grumbling and complaining. It's not okay to have a bad attitude. It's okay to be sad. But at the same time, in the case of a good listener and somebody else is being rewarded and you wanted to be rewarded, you need to cheer them on. You need to learn to be able to look at them and say, I know I was a good listener. I didn't get chosen today. That's okay. I'm glad they got chosen, you know, because they listened really well too. I'm going to cheer them on. And so there's a life lesson inside choosing good listeners that you can use with your kids to help them understand how real life works, how you don't always win in life, and that's okay. How when you don't get your way, how you're supposed to respond. And so good listener awards, you can use a variety of things. We use ribbons most of the year. During Christmas time, we may give away candy canes or the big candy cane things full of M&Ms. During summertime, we might give away some bug catching stuff. Like we did a theme, what's bugging you? Kids ask their questions. We answer their questions. We gave away bug things for the good listeners. And so it can tie into your theme as well. Now, if you can send something home with everybody, that's great too. Still do the Good Listener Award, but something to help them remember through the week. So every time you see this, every time you use this pencil, every time you let it call to mind what we talked about today. And so if you can send something small home, I know there's some churches every week they send something home, and that's all right. We don't do it every week. We do it from time to time. A couple of reasons. One is I don't want to do it just to do it. I don't want my kids to always come expecting to take something home. I'd rather surprise them or have a giveaway that I can use as a hook to say, come to church, we're giving such and such away.